Next on Enviro Close-Up, Philippe Carillo's The Fukushima Disaster, the hidden side of the story. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman with Philippe Carillo, who directed the just-released film documentary, The Fukushima Disaster, The Hidden Side of the Story. It's among the strongest films ever made about the dangers of nuclear technology. Welcome, Philippe.
Thank you very much, Carl. I'm very happy to be with you today.
First off, this is a huge project, a comprehensive and impressive film. Why did you jump into doing all this work and making this film?
It was a huge project. I actually thought it would be less work, but the more I was digging into the topic, the more I was learning about how big the topic was. But I decided to do this film after my previous film about the garbage trash in the ocean. Some researcher told me that among all the pollution and the plastic trash that was coming after the tsunami in Japan, in the coast of Alaska, mainly Alaska, and then British Columbia and California and everything, the west coast of the US, there was also radiation. And nobody really did the research on that or a film about it. So I said, okay, maybe that's my chance to expose that. And then I guess I care for the future of this planet. I care for the people of this planet, and I care for my kids too, you know, to have a good future. So that's what give me the power and the force behind, you know, doing this film. It was a lot of work. It was 1 year of work, basically.
Now, you're from France, but you've been living for a bunch of years now on Vanuatu. I mean, it's an archipelago of islands, an island nation in the Pacific. The Fukushima catastrophe affected so much of the world, but it's particularly impacted on the Pacific, and with plans now to dump liquid waste from the Fukushima nuclear plants, it stands to impact the Pacific nations, the people of the Pacific, even more. Now, everybody knows there was this tsunami, and it hit this site of 6 nuclear reactors in Japan, this Fukushima Daiichi site. But most people have no idea of what happened next. Can you speak about what happened next? What the Tokyo Electric Power Company did, its CEO did, what the Japanese government did, as reported so well in your film.
There's a nuclear mafia in Japan. You know, there is the regulator and the industry are mixed together. This is an illegal collaboration. You can't do that. There's a conflict of interest, of course. So all the what happened is, that's the reason why I believe the CEO of TEPCO locked himself up for 5 days and 5 nights inside his office. He could not face the problem. This guy, he's the CEO. He needed to give order to people. Like, go do, bam, bam, bam. I don't know, do something, because we are going to all die here. But no, he could not face the situation. So that's why there is a lot of stuff that have been hidden behind the scene. Who was manipulating all of that?
It wasn't just TEPCO. In the documentary, you point to the Nuclear Industry Safety Agency in Japan and the Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry, and how they were very much involved in a cover-up.
Yes, yes. That's the reason why, because it doesn't make sense that the CEO locked him up. Himself up, you know, into his office for 5 days and 5 nights, you know, and then because there was other power at work, so he was probably giving order or didn't want to face anything anymore because there was a conflict of interest everywhere. So basically the government was saying, okay, don't say anything, don't do anything. We are trying to calm down the situation or something, you know. But, you know, you can read kind of between the lines. The thing is, the journalists, the TV didn't say to people that the nuclear, three nuclear reactor exploded. It was not the news what not spread. So that's why people were in the dark. They didn't know what to do. So they didn't know where the radiation was going and stuff like this. And that's why Naoto Kan, the former prime minister, you know, could not even give order. And each time he was giving order, it was the wrong order because he didn't have the right information at the time.
Now, Naoto Kan, who was then the prime minister of Japan, he appears in the documentary and he tells of how he ordered all the nuclear power plants in Japan to be shut down and for the country to move towards renewable energy. But then you had a very pro-nuclear fellow, Shinzo Abe, the late Shinzo Abe. He becomes Japan's prime minister, and he just renewed the push for nuclear power in Japan, which is continuing. I mean, they're talking in Japan now of a renaissance of nuclear power. You talk about a nuclear mafia in Japan. It's quite a collection of pro-nuclear forces these days. Naoto Kan was, he was a very solitary and singular figure.
Yes, that's right. That's right. The mafia is, I will not say it online, but there is a mafia that is controlled by another international mafia. And people can do their research online. So, you know, why we have nuclear plant anyway? To create electricity, really? I find out that the basic lie of the nuclear industry is to tell that, oh, we have nuclear power because it creates electricity. This is not the primary goal. The primary goal is to build nuclear weapons. And France is involved. US is involved in dealing with plutonium because the waste is stored somewhere and manage how you want to call that, reprocess or whatever to become like plutonium grade, war grade plutonium, basically. And then it's sold. France, they have an exchange of, you know, this kind of stuff. So, and I believe now, you know, Japan is building an arsenal of bombs as well, you know, just for national security, which is understandable, but not following, you know, the non-proliferation treaty about nuclear weapon is insane because then if there is a nuclear war, then that's it. No more life on Earth. That will be over. So it's all personal interest, and there is this kind of people who don't care about life, basically, you know, and then this, the whole thing is completely insane. We have behind the scene people completely insane who are, you know, pulling the string, basically. You know?
Yeah, every nuclear power plant, including those in Japan, produces hundreds of pounds of plutonium. Quite ironically, the Nagasaki bomb was fueled with plutonium, about 10 pounds of this stuff. And here Japan has all these reactors. In fact, so does the United States, so does Russia. They're all over the world producing plutonium, which could be made into a nuclear weapon. The two sides of the same coin, really, nuclear weapons, and on the other side, commercial nuclear power, and they're quite interlinked all over. Yeah, Naoto Kan came to Manhattan to talk. We did a video, an Enviro video, on his presentation in Manhattan. Very noble and brave man. And speaking of noble and brave, Arnie Gundersen. He was a nuclear engineer. He's now a principal of Fairewinds Energy Education. It's an organization. It's in Vermont in the United States. And I'm just quoting him from the film, your film. The world is already seeing deaths from cancer related to the Fukushima disaster. And this is Arnie Gundersen, who broke from the nuclear industry. There'll be many more cancer deaths, again in your film, says Arnie Gundersen, more over time. Internationally, the International Atomic Energy Agency and officials in Japan won't admit to the issue of who have died because of Fukushima and who stand to die now. But in your documentary, it becomes quite clear that death is going to happen because of that disaster.
That's right. And in Japan, for instance, after Fukushima, there was this secret law that had been passed by the Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, saying that if you link any cancer or any disease to Fukushima, you can go to jail. There was a censure, a complete censure of the information and the data at the time. And they wanted to basically silence everyone because they wanted to restart all the nuclear plant. So Shinzo Abe was just a puppet, to be honest with you, puppet of the nuclear industry that is so powerful because of money. And again, because of the nuclear bomb and the national security. So now we're talking about big deal, really big deal, okay? These people are not joking, they are warrior in a sense, not to protect, but just to make sure they are going to send, the nuclear bomb before the other one send the bomb, stuff like this. This is insanity, really. But this is really what happened, other than that, let's talk about the Pacific region, okay, for instance, because I know you already know, you probably talk about it already, but in the Pacific region, who understand the nuke speak? Carl, they don't understand nothing. They just understand like Hilda Lini, who won the nuclear free award. Hilda Lini understand that. I talked to her, she's a friend of mine here. And she understand what happened because she was a minister of health a long time ago here in Vanuatu. So she understand the implication of this matter of radiation, nuclear radiation, But other than that, Japan here, they are brainwashing everyone about their dumping now of they said it's treated water. They don't even call that radioactive water. So tritium, in their opinion, is not radioactive. Of course not, right? I mean, really? So they are telling people it's treated water. It's not pollution. It's not radioactive water. I'm sorry, tritium is a radioactive isotope. And now we have the confirmation from different scientists around the world that they didn't test all the other isotopes, such as iodine-129. Ah, okay, that's the next one. And then cesium-137. So it's difficult to convince people that it's going to create a problem, a health problem here in Vanuatu or here in the Pacific with cancer. And then, of course, we not know where it's coming from because people now that die from cancer is normal, right? Is the new normal. Are people dying for cancer? No problem, whatever. So that's real like issue because we have to educate people. And I did the film also to educate people in a sense where what is radiation? What it does to your body? It has to be explained in a way where simple people can understand. Otherwise, you're going to take 1 year to understand a topic. What an isotope? What radiation? What is blah, blah, blah? What is, so... It's really like a big work of education. There is a Japanese ambassador here, and I want to say it, publicly right now. They are trying to censor me here. All right. I did a screening of my film for journalists, and they came over at the University of Vanuatu, and they came over and talked to the president of the university and said, "Hey, that's not normal. You cannot do that." And then the professor, the president of the university said, "Excuse me, this is educational, so it has to be shown. If you want to say something, you say something, but you cannot just stop a filmmaker to broadcast a film." And then same thing happened at the local TV and the local newspaper. So basically, the guy, the ambassador, they didn't come to me and say, "Philippe, want to give you some information." No, they didn't even come to me because they know I already know everything about it. So what you gonna do? Brainwash me? No, they can't. So then they come after me to try to stop people who don't know too much about this matter to stop me to spreading the news here. That's insane.
Dr. Helen Caldicott, she's a former president of Physicians for Social Responsibility. She appears in your documentary and does a brilliant job explaining radioactivity. I mean, I'm quoting her from the film, "There is no safe level of radiation. I repeat," says Dr. Caldicott, "there is no safe level of radiation. Each dose of radiation is cumulative and adds to your risk of getting cancer." And that's absolutely documented, she says, in the medical literature. And she continues explaining the impacts of radioactivity. And you speak of tritium, which is in the tons and tons of water that it can't be filtered out. It's radioactive hydrogen. And when it combines with water, it turns water into, instead of H2O, H3O, radioactive water. And the plan is to dump 1.3 million tons of radioactive water into the Pacific from the Fukushima site.
Helen is somebody that was very interesting. She is full of information. This lady is amazing. She's one of the peaceful warriors that we need, you know, in this world. She has been fighting the nuclear industry for a long time. She gets attacked by people, by institutions and governments, because she's labeled anti-nuke, you know. I will say, we are not anti-nuke, we are pro-life. That's very different. And she has a lot of knowledge, because she, her teacher, I believe, was John Goffman. And John Goffman was, I mean, come on, you know, you read his book, you will know. And she's right, there is no safe level of radiation. The sentence of Helen was so good, I have to use it. You know, there is no safe level of radiation. I repeat, there is no safe level of radiation. This is what John Goffman said. It's all cumulative. So basically, every level, you know, you get is cumulative and add to the amount you already have, and you can get cancer, of course, and sick.
Yeah, Dr. Goffman was an MD, a PhD. I've interviewed him. He was involved in the Manhattan Project time with plutonium. He became associate director of Lawrence Livermore Laboratory. And then when he realized all of what he was involved in, he, one of these brave people, courageous people who broke from the, it's not just a nuclear mafia in Japan, he broke from the nuclear mafia in the United States. He wrote a book called Poisoned Power. And incidentally, Helen Caldicott was very involved where I live, many thousands of miles from where you are now, on Long Island in New York, near New York City, where the plan was to build 7 to 11 nuclear power plants. This is the 60s, the 70s, the 80s. The plan was to turn Long Island into this is in the jargon of the nuclear promoters of the time, a nuclear park. And Dr. Caldicott was very involved in the fight against the first of these 7 to 11 Shoreham, and then about 4 near Shoreham in Jamesport. I remember her testifying at the hearings on the Jamesport nuclear power plant project. Getting back to the dumping of tritiated water into the Pacific, and in the film too, appearing is a member of the Parliament of Vanuatu. Talk about what he says, would you, Philippe?
Okay, yeah, he was saying basically that he's completely against it. He was at a time in the opposition side of the government 1 year ago when they start to when they start to talk about this, and they said no. Sorry, but the Pacific is nuclear free, so we don't want any dumping of nuclear matter, no matter what. And then everybody, you know, this time he's in the government and he's very vocal about it. But what I know is the Japan ambassador tried to talk to him. Another thing I want to tell you is, you know, Japan, they send people all over the Pacific countries to tell them how safe their dumping is going to be. So they did meet with all the journalists in the Pacific region, okay? That's very interesting. So when you come after that, and the journalists, oh, but where they have the, you know, the thing from, you know, the data from the Japanese side, blah, blah. I said, okay, well, I'm going to give you the real data now, okay? And you have to watch my film. So basically, this is a battle of opinion in a sense, because they can just give an opinion with some paper that they brought from the government of Japan, you know, to dam the water. But when you talk to Robert Richmond from the University of Hawaii, for instance, and he knows this topic very well, and he's very, very good. So he said, no, I mean, this is not okay. This is not cool. This is not good to do that anyway. So why Japan continue to not listen to their own people, to the people of South Korea, to the people of the Pacific Island countries, etc.? Everybody is against, but they continue. And the IAEA is involved in what? The IAEA is not here to protect the people anyway. IAEA is here to promote the nuclear industry. So there is a conflict of interest. So IAEA, they are not the regulator. Why we even ask them to do anything in this topic? Come on. I don't trust IAEA. And they are not part of the UN, and the UN seems to be compromised now with a big conflict of interest. The UN should protect the people of Vanuatu, the people of the Pacific Island country, because they don't have the money, they don't have experts here in this country, and they will be wiped out, the first one, you know?
Yeah, the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency, was modeled after the U.S. Atomic Energy Commission, which in fact was disbanded by the U.S. Congress in 1974 for being in conflict of interest, both promoting and regulating nuclear power in the United States. It was replaced by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, the Department of Energy. Here, though, on the international platform or level, you have the IAEA promoting and regulating at the same time a conflict of interest, nuclear power, and saying, yes, yes, we can dump all this tritiated water into the Pacific. Talking about an agency which should be like the Atomic Energy Commission disbanded, the IAEA should be disbanded too. Now, again, the film is so powerful, so important. How can people see it? Where can they see it? Wherever they live around the world.
Well, you can see it on Amazon, you can see it on iTunes, Apple TV, Google Play, and Vimeo On Demand. So the film is available if they search the right keyword. So if you enter the complete title, The Fukushima Disaster, The Hidden Side of the Story, you will find it. And that's it. And people need to watch it. Really, you need to spend a little bit of time and very little money, you know, to just watch the film, because it's very educational. And this is very important to protect the life of the people, protect the future of this planet, and protect the life of our descendants.
Absolutely. And just let me mention that Yoichi Shimatsu, I hope I'm pronouncing his name correctly, he used to work for the journalist. He worked for the Japan Times. And he speaks of, he points a finger, and this is a Japanese journalist, at the Japanese government and these TEPCO for minimizing and denying the impacts of the Fukushima disaster in Japan. A very important person that you present in the film.
Yes, I think he was instrumental to put all the dots together, to understand what was going on behind the curtain, you know, and like this we say, ah, okay, so that, now it makes sense. What he's saying, and he's saying blah, 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 blah. Now the whole thing makes sense. You know, why Japan want to dump the water into the Pacific Ocean? This is not their ocean. This is the ocean of 41 countries. So why you dump the thing into the Pacific Ocean? It's going to come to us. It's going to kill us at some point. We don't want that. And Japan need to understand they are not the only one here, okay? So if we decide and if we say no, they should not dump the water. You know, we cannot say we, the people, like in America, but we, the people of the Pacific Island, we will fight back, believe me.
The other side, speaking of coins, is there's no need for this. You know, Japan could get all the energy it needs. It's a great place for geothermal energy. I mean, it's a string of volcanic islands. The wind blows very strong. I've been to Japan. To impose all these nuclear power plants on Japan, and then to see, I mean, three of them in front of our eyes. I mean, the video has been shown over and over again. And this is about something which the nuclear industry always said couldn't happen. Nuclear plants can't explode. Well, they did in Fukushima. And now pushing again this nuclear renaissance in Japan, in an island nation which, like the whole world, doesn't need nuclear power.
That's okay. And that's exactly right. And now I will finish by saying what Helen Caldicott said. They lied, and they will lie again to save their industry. They will. So we have to really understand the nuke speak or what's going on in order to stop them and say, okay, that's it.
Well, Philippe, thank you so much for making this this important and such a well-crafted, well-done, powerful film. Everybody should see it. Everybody should see this expose. Thank you for being with us from the an island of paradise in the Pacific, but there's no hiding. Oh, it's like an old American joke of somebody who in the late 1930s wanted to go find a paradise somewhere, so he went from the United States to settle in Guadalcanal. I mean, it's a joke, but it's not a joke. Because we all, in fact, with nuclear power, I think, live in Guadalcanal. Thanks again, and thank you for watching. I'm Carl Grossman.
Thank you very much, Carl. Thank you so much. Thank you very much for everything, okay? If you want to come to Vanuatu, don't hesitate, okay? You have nice palm tree here and nice beaches, okay?
Would be a pleasure.
People need to watch the film because they need to know what are the issues that we are talking about. We know we are a nuclear-free state, but that's a big word, but we need to know what it is. Especially the younger generation, they have not been told about this, and they need to watch the film to know what is it.
In 2015, marine scientists found that the radiation from Fukushima had reached the west coast of Canada. Despite the low level found along the coast, the unanswered question remains. In the long run, how much of this low-level radiation could harm marine life and human life? And since Fukushima is still leaking, what about the accumulation of radiation that will increase in the years to come? Scientists and oceanographers found tuna with traces of Fukushima-related contamination across the Pacific on the shores of the United States. Aside from the leakage and dumping into the ocean, since 2011, Fukushima Daiichi has accumulated more than 1 million tons of wastewater stored in more than 1,000 tanks on the land of the nuclear plant. It ran out of land for water tanks by 2022. It has been suggested that the government could have solved the problem by allocating more land surrounding the power plant for water tanks, since the surrounding area had been designated as unsuitable for humans.